everyone, I am Mads Barnkop from Kaiser Power Electronics, and today I would like to show you another Ericsson radio base station. This is another version of the 3000 series system. This is the RBS3206, which is a larger version, maybe a earlier version than the macro system I showed you a couple of videos back. This is a 2.1 GHz 3G system, the VCDMA standard. The particular unit we're going to look at is called the Radio Unit 21 for 2100 MHz. So let's take a look at the unit, shall we? So here we have it, the Ericsson Radio Unit 21, 2130, the model number. It's a 2100 MHz unit. If we just take a look at the side of it, we can see this is the diplexer side or system board side, and the huge heat sink we have on the other side is where we have the amplifiers sitting against, maybe also the diplexer. In the bottom we only have a multi-port of some kind. Looking at the front, we have a transmitting input. We have two data ports for the system control board connection. There's a field unit control connection for the service engineers. There is a receive A and B outputs, and there is a DC power input. So with all the screws undone, let's see what's underneath the shielding. Okay, here we have the back side of the board. So if we can get that up. And it comes off in a whole piece. There was a multi-pin header connection here. The two RF connectors we have up here in the corner, they connect up to two DACs. So we have the bus. Let's take a look, closer look. We have the bus connection to the system controller board. We have a Altera hard copy, which does the protocol translation. We have digital to analog converters, two outputs to the power amplifier. Over here, this has to be to do with the transceiving part. But what is a little funny is that here we have a analog to digital converter, but we also have one here and one up here where we actually have a connector to the power amplifier or diplexer below. But it also seems like we're missing a whole bunch of parts here, which could be the high speed front end to do the analog to digital conversion, which seems to be missing. So maybe this is just a standalone transmitting unit. But let's take a look at the power amplifier and diplexer beneath. So with all the screws removed and the RF power transistors carefully taken off the board, we can see that this is just a large heatsink with the power amplification and the power supply sitting on it, which is actually a shame, is that the heatsink is completely unusable for anything else, because it has all these machined rooms in it for the tracks and so on underneath the board. So we had hoped this would make for a good flat heatsink for our projects. It's just trash now. Looking at the power transistors, they pretty much sit very tight against the plastic fitting here. And we can see this nice Infineon RF transistor as new, because it wasn't soldered in. That is great.
So this is the circuit board of the amplifier module itself. I will mark up the different components with a red dot when I talk about them. First, we have the AUC CPU, which is part of the main processing cluster. Each amplifier module has one of these CPUs. The way this cluster works is if one CPU fails in the whole cabinet, and say that only five amplifiers are working, then these five will handle all the protocol encoding decoding for the sixth amplifier as well, assuming that its other parts are still working. Next, we have the Ericsson Warp 1 CPU. This is a ASIC controller which handles the encoding of the analog signals back into the digital data stream. On the left side, we have the whole receive part, which will be discussed later on in more detail. Down in the right corner, we first have the Altera Hard Copy 2, which is a 350 MHz ASIC. This handles the digital telecom protocol decoding into a analog data stream, and that is handled by the components seen in the transmit corner of the board. This will also get explained in more detail later on. At the top of the board, we have the two optical inputs which connect to the whole bus system of the radio base station. And this is how it communicates with the processing units and the other amplifiers. It also has all its system software on this 128 megabyte embedded flash memory. And the CPU itself has a 128 megabyte of SD RAM. From the previous picture of the whole circuit board, we could see the two analog input connectors from the diplexer sitting at the top up here. The first parts that the signal passes through here are the ceramic resonator bandpass filters. I will do a much more detailed description and pulling the cover off one of these right after going through this circuit part for the receiving signal. At the top here, we have two analog devices, ADF4106, which are 6 GHz local oscillators. These supply the MAXIM9993E down conversion mixers. These down convert the signal from a 2 gigahertz to around, as it says, 40 megahertz to 350 megahertz. It's hard to tell really what intermediate frequency they use on this board. But as the signal has been down converted to a lower frequency, it continues down through these four channels to the through the triquant Sortec filters. These are 208 megahertz SAW filters, which is sonic acoustic wave. And if you want to know more about SAW filters in details, I've put a link for one of my other videos where I explain this in greater detail. From here it passes through another pair of down conversion mixers and go through a few passive filters before coming to the analog devices 8080137, which is a unknown analog to digital converter, but it is a two-channeled ADC. From here, the two bitstream data lines are fed over into the Warp 1 CPU, where it's converted back into the digital telecom protocol. Now that we have seen the receiving part in details about the different components, I would just like to show you the high resolution pictures where we can see a bit more details as the whole ground stitching. This is where we have through holes that connect the backplane and the front plane, which is often the grounded layers, or if there are any other grounded layers within the board, this is where they are connected together. Now, if we see here up from the ceramic resonator filters down to the down conversion mixers, it's not apparent exactly where the signal runs up here, but of course it comes from the top and goes some down here in between the filter and the IC. But from the ICs, it's clear that we can see there is a path here. There's a path here, here, and here. As we can see, between the channels, there are some heavy ground stitching, and even around the passive filters and the SAW filter, there's even more ground stitching, following the components very, very close. Now, moving on from the SAW filters to the second pair of down conversion mixers. Again, we can see the missing ground stitching. This is where the signal runs, buried deep down in the board. Goes down here to the two-channeled down conversion mixer. From here again, we can see it passes on through these channels down to a little passive filter. And again, we can see the clearance where it goes down, and here we can see it. Here we have one channel going down. This must be the second channel, so if it's coming up down here maybe. And here we can see we have ground stitching around, maybe going down here, and the other one passing through here down to the second input. And from here the digital lines run down deep into the board, somewhere where it connects over to the Warp 1 encoding CPU. And now on to the detailed description of the ceramic resonator filter. Here is a close-up picture of the coaxial ceramic resonator with the shielding removed. Here we can see that there are three pins connecting the input to the three pieces of ceramic. These ceramic coaxial resonators are widely used in cell phones, GPS receivers, and other wireless devices. It is a bandpass filter which uses capacitively coupled shunt resonators, which can be seen that they are not electrically connected, but sits next to each other on a isolated bar. If we take a look at the back, we can see that there is also a hole at the back of the resonator. And from this small equivalent schematic, it is shown that this is a half-wave application filter, as it has a hole going through the whole ceramic piece, whereas the quarter wave application has a fully metallized backside. Now, if we move on to see here the equivalent schematic of the filter that we have present here, that a nth order filter has to use n number of sections of a high dielectric constant and low loss ceramic material. For each section, this means that we have a even better filter, so we can take a look at how this is calculated. It's fairly simple that you take your carrier frequency and you decide on a stop frequency. Then you also take in the bandwidth of your filtering quality. And by this simple equations, you can select the number of sections that are needed in order to filter your signal as good as you want. But on the other hand, you will also have insertion losses, which is calculated per section. So if you say that you have 9 times as good filtering with the double amount of sections, well, then you also have twice as much losses. So it's all a weighing up against the filter quality versus the losses. Now we look at the transmitting part of the printed circuit board. That up here in the top, we can see the Altera hardcopy 2 CPU that translates the digital protocols into a single data stream, which is fed over into the two DACs, which is two channels, 16-bit, 500 megasamples per second. These DACs from Texas Instruments feeds down into the two filters here. So we have again two channels with two phases each. And with the analog devices clock distribution chip, along with its 10 megahertz signal and another clock generator that we have here, the upconversion to the almost 2 gigahertz signal is happening in these IRF ICs. I have not been able to find any real good data on these ICs. Down at the bottom we have the local oscillator for the upconversion mixers, and here we have the two connectors for the diplexer. Looking up close, there are not so much details in the transmitting part as there were in the receiving part, but we can take a look. Here we have first the DAC, which feeds its signals down through this ground stitching here to the passive filter. From here it goes on to the upconversion mixer. And from here we can see that the one signal goes down here, but another goes over into some serious trapping or labyrinth-like pattern here, but also seems to connect over here, so I'm not completely sure if this is just some kind of phase conversion trick that's being done here. Over to the side here we can see the local oscillator circuit. It's shielded, so underneath here there is a chip along with all its passive components. Above here we have the 200 megahertz local clock, and again here up here we had the 1.2 gigahertz clock synchronization chip. This amplifier is a 2G or edge amplifier, but it also contains a single channel 3G or VCDMA receiver. Up here we have the input from the diplexer. This goes up into a down conversion mixer, which is the Maxim Max 9996. This down converts the signal to somewhere between 40 and 350 megahertz, all depending on how high the local oscillator is running and what the intermediate frequency is. But from here we can see that the ground stitching is broken with two lines, comes down here through a lot of passive filtering before entering the 12-bit 125 megasamples per second analog to digital converter. From here the signal might be lost, as it can be seen there are simply no components installed in this amplifier, or it could be that it's routed completely across the board over to the other encoding CPU. Before moving on to the power amplifier itself, we can take a look at the power supply that sits at the same circuit board as the power amplifier. This also supplies the other logic boards with the power through this connector. Down in the right corner we have the DC input connector. From here we have some what looks like the main switching power supply. From here it distributes out to at least 1, 2, 3, maybe a fourth power supply. So it seems that we have maybe a power supply for each of the power MOSFET output transistors and one for the pre-amplifiers for these. If we just take a quick look at the board up here, that we have the preamplifiers and the power MOSFETs. But these we will take a look at a picture with some names on it. The power amplifier board is one of the most beautiful with all its gold plating. Now, up here in the left corner we have the inputs to the power amplifier from the main circuit board's digital to analog converters. From here it passes through a few Singer JP503S hybrid couplers. This is to make the necessary phase shifts before going into the two lanes, or the two amplifier MOSFETs. First we have a Freescale preamplifier IC. I have been unable to find any data on this preamplifier's characteristics. But the power output transistors are Infineon high power RF LD MOSFETs, which are rated for 180 watts dissipation. The combined output of these two power MOSFETs goes through a Singer 2 coupler, where it goes into the output circulator. As I mentioned earlier, the circulator works by a simple magnetic principle, where a current entering at port 1 can only exit at port 2 to the output, but any energy reflected back from the diplexer into the amplifier again can only go to port 3, which goes into a 50 ohm end termination. And there are no energy trying to go from port 3 to 1, or any energy will try to go that way, but there is nothing left. No energy can at any point go from 2 to 1, so it's impossible to get any energy reflected back from the diplex and antenna array into the amplifier. As can be seen on the power MOSFETs, these were not soldered in, but these were mounted with a pretty nice pressure mount, which also means that removing these two screws was enough to take out the transistor in one whole piece. Unfortunately, the high resolution pictures of the power amplifier board is a little blurry out at the edges. But if we start up here at the inputs, we can follow the signal through the hybrid couplers, which then goes on through the heavy ground stitching to the pre-amplifier IC. We can see that there are missing some SMD components or capacitors all along the signal line. This has to do with the fact that this amplifier board is made for more than one frequency. So it could be used for like both 2G and Edge, but also 3D and VCDMA, and perhaps also 4G and LTE technologies. The signal moves on from here down through what could be a maybe mini circulator or a test point. Here we can see the power MOSFET itself, where we have the bias lines coming in from the side, and we have the power supply sitting out here at the edges. As we can see, the power supply lines are often connected by quarter wave or quarter wave length tracks in order to suppress any noise from entering the power supply or coming from the power supply and into the data line. The output from the power MOSFETs are then combined, and as there is a difference in the length between the tracks, it could mean that we have a phase offset. So this is perhaps a Dorothy amplifier setup. There is another link down in the video description for a video explaining more about a Dorothy amplifier. From here, the signal goes to the last Singer hybrid coupler, where it enters the circulator, and here is the output connector. So, I hope you enjoyed watching the video. I hope you learned something about radio base station technologies. And if you want to watch more videos like this or about high voltage, then subscribe to my channel. And if you want to discuss some of your own projects or want to ask for help, then come to the forum, highvoltageforum.net, and the community will most likely be glad to help you move on with your projects. So, see you later.